welcome you to this video segment on sedimentary rocks. So sedimentary rocks, there are three components of sedimentary rocks, and these are rocks that typically are the result of erosion of other rocks. So in physical geology, we look at those processes of erosion and how that breaks down other rocks to actually form little clasts or particles. So we have an entire group of sedimentary rocks that are formed of those little particles that have been broken off from other rocks. So the other rocks could have been igneous rocks, they could be other sedimentary rocks, or they could be metamorphic rocks. So when we're looking at clastic sedimentary rocks, we're looking at the size of the particle. So there's an entire range. Basically anything that's considered large particles is anything bigger than 2 millimeters. Now 2 millimeters is pretty small. It goes from 2 millimeters up to giant boulders. That's considered a large particle. From 2 millimeters, it goes very, very, very tiny until it's very difficult to even discern an individual class or individual particle. And that smallest size is clay. Clay is the smallest particle size. So let's first look at how those rocks range. So in your largest particle size, we have these rocks where you can see the large particles. You can see the light colored pebbles, and they're cemented together. So we have large pebbles that are cemented together by smaller, finer grain. It's called a matrix. So what we're looking at on these, we're actually looking at the size of the pebbles and the shape of the pebbles, because that tells us how and where it formed. Now, why do we care how and where it formed? Sedimentary rocks are the key to learning about Earth's past climate, as well as its life that existed on the planet. So if you want to go fossil hunting, you're going to be looking at sedimentary rocks. If you want to learn about what the climate was like in a particular region of the country or the world, you're going to look at sedimentary rocks, because these are the pieces of the puzzle that we use to fit together to answer those questions. So looking at the largest pebbles, we're looking at the shape of the pebbles. So we already see that the pebbles that are in these rocks are big. They're over 2 millimeters. So we're looking at the shape. This one has really sharp angular pebbles. So it's going to have grains and particles that have lots of angles. This one has rounded pebbles. So they're much more rounded. They can be oval in shape, but all the edges have been smoothed out, so there's no sharp edges anymore. So what that tells us where it was deposited and if it's traveled at all. So if you have a rock that has sharp angular edges on the pebbles, then we know that that rock broke off from the original rock, usually on a mountain, and it just fell down. And it hasn't moved since then. And so these rocks continue to fall off the mountain, and they accumulate, and they make this rock, and this rock is called a breccia. So breccia has broken angular grains, and it's found at the base of mountains. This rock with the large round pebbles, you know, it started, these pebbles started angular, but what happened is they were picked up and moved. Now typically what picks up and moves things is water. Wind can pick up smaller particles, but it's not going to pick up these big pebbles. It takes water to pick up these big pebbles. So water picked up and moved those pebbles, and those angular pebbles began to roll, and they smashed into each other. And as that happened, those sharp angles disappeared and they became rounded. So the rounder the pebble is, the longer it's traveled from its original source. So these pebbles also came from a mountain sometime long time ago, but they went into a river and they were moved down the river and they were rounded over time. So these have traveled a lot more. This rock is called a conglomerate. So conglomerates have large rounded pebbles. The next group of clastic rocks are sandstones. Sandstones come in a variety of colors, and each color can tell us where it was deposited at. So for instance, if I want to go dinosaur hunting, where do dinosaurs live? Well, dinosaurs live on land. They did not live in the ocean. So they lived on land, so I'm going to look for those sedimentary rocks that form on land in likely places where dinosaurs may have lived. So this particular type of sandstone, and we can tell it's a sandstone because the particle size is smaller. We're going to go down in size, but it feels rough, like sandpaper. You're going to actually feel a texture to it. So a lot of these sedimentary rocks, you're going to be able to feel the rock and feel how it's different from one rock to the next rock. So this one is called a lithic sandstone, and it's kind of a tan color. And lithic sandstone forms in rivers and streams. It's going to be there, that's the sand that's there with these pebbles that form the conglomerate. So we might find a T-Rex, you know, that went to the river to get a drink of water, and while he was at the river, for some reason he died, fell in the river. We might find him with lithic sandstone. So the other kind of sandstone we have one that has a lot of pink in it. And if you go back to the mineral group that you looked at, you may recall that there's a feldspar that was pink, potassium feldspar. Well, that's what's in this sandstone. We find potassium feldspar near mountains. So this type of sandstone forms at the base of mountains, just like the breccia did. So these two form at the base of mountains. There's no water involved at all. They just fall off the mountain and they form at the base of mountains. This last type of sandstone is called quartz aragonite sandstone, and in this case, all the extra minerals are gone. We don't have the extra minerals like the feldspars, and sometimes you see micas that are in the Arkose sandstone, but quartz aragonite sandstone, it's been washed clean. It is just quartz and nothing else. Well, this forms in beaches, and that's the ocean. Takes away all those other minerals, dissolves them, and it leaves behind quartz, because quartz is a very hard mineral. So it's going to be white and cream in color. So you can see your sandstones come in a variety of colors, so the way to distinguish sandstone is by texture. If you have a magnifying glass or jeweler's loop, you should be able to see the individual particles on the sandstone. The next one down, a little bit smaller particles, is siltstone. Now, this one is going to have a different texture. You should still feel a texture, but it's going to be different. It's going to be much smaller, much smoother than the sandstone. A lot of people will lick it. Doesn't hurt to do that. Feels a little bit rough on your tongue, siltstone. And this one, too, a lot of people might mistake it for limestone. But siltstone has no calcite in it, so it's not going to bubble, it's not going to react with acid. I can put acid on it, nothing's going to happen. But siltstone is a smaller particle size. It is typically this gray color. It can be a little bit more white in color too. But again, it's going to feel different texture. And then the smallest particle size is clay, and that clay creates shale. Shale does come in different colors, typically red, green, and black. It could be in a lighter color, like a more of a cream color, but that's pretty rare. Black is your most common color for shale, and this forms in either swampy areas due to a lack of oxygen, or in the deepest part of the ocean, where again, there's a lack of oxygen. So those are your clastic rocks. Now I wanted to show you this because it's kind of cool. This is a big piece of sandstone. So I don't know if you can see, I'm going to move it around a little bit. You can see these kind of ridges going across here. Well, what this is, these are ripple marks. So if you go to a beach or river and you see the water flowing and it creates ripples in the sand, that's what this is. These ripples have been fossilized. They're solid rock. And they've been preserved forever in this rock. So finding a rock like this tells you what? Tells you what kind of environment was there. It tells you that there was water flowing. If you carefully examine the ripples, if it flows in one direction, the ripples are going to have one shape versus if the water flows in two directions. Now, flowing in one direction, it's going to be a river. Flowing in two directions means you're near the beach and you have tides that go in and out. So each one of those can tell us the environment of deposition, and from that you can also infer the types of animals or plants that might also have fossils nearby. So this is an example of ripple marks, and that particular piece came from Indiana. So then the next group that we have is limestone. Now, you only have one limestone sample, but I want you to understand there's several different limestones. All of the limestones form in the ocean. It's a marine rock. So when I use the word marine, that means it's in the ocean, versus freshwater, which means it formed on land. It's terrestrial. So all of the limestones that there are have a primary component. You might recognize this mineral. This is calcite. It has that rhombohedral crystal habit. Also has rhombohedral cleavage. So if I break it, it's going to break into rhombohedrals. And if you remember calcite, we put a little acid on it, and it's going to fizz up and bubble. Well, the same thing happens with these limestones. Calcite is the major component in these limestones, so all of them are going to react in some way. Some may react a lot, some may react just a little to the acid. So that one fizzes up nicely. And so we have a variety of limestones. This is just a basic micrite limestone. It tends to be gray in color, could be very dark gray also, and it has no fossils at all in it. Then we have another gray limestone. This one has weathering, so that's what that brown surface is. It means that rain has fallen on it and changed the color. But this has fossils in it, so then it becomes fossiliferous limestone. Then we have limestone that's composed of just broken up seashells. And this is a special type of limestone called coquina, and it means broken seashells. Then we have another type of limestone called oolitic limestone. And this has little tiny calcite crystals that have been moved on a beach area back and forth until they become rounded. And then they cement together. So there's little tiny round spheres inside this oolitic limestone. And then the last type, which I did show you in the mineral section, is chalk. Chalk is a type of limestone also. So it's composed of the little dead bodies of microorganisms from the ocean, forms in deep areas, and we can see it's highly, highly reactive to the diluted hydrochloric acid. And you can see I'm wiping it off because that acid's going to continue to react with it, and it'll actually wear away the rock. So that's your limestones. Then we have chert. Chert actually forms when we have dissolved quartz in the water, and it is often used, it replaces organic material, or it can form in the deep, deep ocean. So what is unique about chert is that it has a lot of properties. It is quartz, so it has all the same properties of quartz. It's going to cut glass if you try and cut glass with it. It's also going to have that conchoidal fracturing. We last saw that conchoidal fracturing with obsidian, which is volcanic glass. So conchoidal fracturing is kind of that half circle type of fracture. You know, like if you break glass and look at the edge of the glass, it kind of has that circular pattern on the edge of the glass. That's called conchoidal fracturing. And chert has the exact same thing because it's a quartz product. Chert often replaces organic material. So this is a piece of petrified wood, and it's been replaced with chert on the inside. And then the last group of rocks, we actually have a couple more, are those that are formed chemically. So the chert is also formed chemically. But we also have this gypsum. So this is a rock gypsum, selenite. This particular one is called selenite. And it forms in layers, nice layered rock. It typically is clear, extremely soft. You can easily scratch this with your fingernail. And then we also have rock salt. So this is the natural color of salt that forms when we evaporate seawater. And all salt on the entire planet formed originally in an ocean. Now, they may be mining it out from underground, but what that tells you is there used to be an ocean that covered that area. So all salt comes from an ocean. So just like the mineral salt, you can lick this and it's salt. So it has a gray color because it also contains the other natural minerals that are in seawater. And then the last two that I'm going to show you, I don't think that you have them as rocks you have to know, but I just wanted to show them to you. These are biological in origin, and they come from plants. The one is coal. Coal comes from leaves and stems and trunks of plants, and it takes about 15 feet of plant material compressed down to make 1 foot of coal. Now, here in the United States and on other continents, there are hundreds of feet of coal. So I want you to think about, you have to have prolific plant life. It has to be going crazy, growing. Well, in order to have that kind of growth in plants, you need a couple things. You need nice warm temperatures, and you need some rainfall. So the temperatures on Earth have varied greatly in the past. We are actually in a very cold climate right now. Even though you hear talks of it, you know, warming up, we're actually still in a very cold period. And in the past, the Earth was significantly warmer. A lot more carbon dioxide, too. And so we had prolific plant growth around the planet, and that's how we have 300 or 400 feet of coal, because the plants just went crazy and grew. Now, the other thing that comes from plants is amber. Amber is the exact same material that you put on your pancakes in the morning. Maple syrup is tree sap, and that's exactly what amber is. Amber's just been petrified. So if you took your maple syrup and allowed it to petrify, it would become amber. A lot of times when you have a sample of amber, you can smell it, and it'll kind of have a piney smell. You'll definitely have a plant smell to it, and that is, you know, the residue from the plant. So how this forms is that typically, plants typically have the greatest amount of sap going up in the trees in the springtime. And so we have a large volume of sap going upwards. You have a spring storm come in, knock some trees over into a nearby pond or river, and those trees go to the bottom and they become fossilized. They get covered up, and that tree sap that was rising in the tree becomes a fossil, becomes an actual rock. So that is a very quick introduction to sedimentary rocks. So we have our clastic rocks that form from particles. We have our marine rocks that are biological in origin, so that's all your limestones. Then we have the chemically precipitated rocks like your chert, your gypsum, and your rock salt. And then you also have the fully biologic, which is your coal and amber. So I hope that helps you identify your sedimentary rocks. Again, if you're using the acid, be very careful with it. The limestone will react with acid, nothing else will. So if it's reacting with acid, it's one of your limestones. So if you have any questions, be sure to email me and I'll try to answer them for you. And so that's it for sedimentary rocks.